In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. O my God, I firmly believe that you are one God and three divine persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe that your divine Son became man and died for our sins, and that he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe these and all the truths which the Holy Catholic Church teaches, because you have revealed them, who can neither deceive nor be deceived. Amen. Blessed Queen of Heaven,
Sovereign Mistress of the Angels, who did receive from the beginning the mission and the power to crush the serpent's head, we beseech thee to send thy holy angels, that under thy command and by thy power, they may pursue the evil spirits, encounter them on every side, resist their bold attacks, and drive them hence into the abyss of woe. Most Holy Mother, send thy holy angels to defend us and to drive the cruel enemy from us. O good and tender Mother, thou shalt ever be our love and our hope. Holy angels and archangels, keep and defend us. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, by means of the powerful intercession of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, your well-beloved spouse, enlighten us, guide us, and increase in us all the virtues necessary to live a life totally devoted to Jesus through Mary. Instill in our hearts a filial love and dependence on the Mother of God.
Give us great
confidence in her maternal heart and an abiding refuge in her mercy, so that by her you may truly form in us Jesus Christ, great and mighty, unto the fullness of his perfect age. Amen. Mother of Good Counsel,
pray for us.
Our Lady of Fatima,
pray for us.
Our Lady of Guadalupe, patroness of the unborn,
pray for us.
Saints Joachim and Anne,
pray for us.
Saint Joseph, patron of the Universal Church,
pray for us.
Saint Maximian Kolbe,
pray for us.
Blessed Teresa of Calcutta,
pray for us.
Blessed John Paul the Great,
pray for us.
Our patron saints and guardian angels,
pray for us.
And I'd like to add Father Patrick Gaffney. Pray for us. He passed away this summer on July the 1st, Feast of the Precious Blood, right when we were having our total consecration retreat at the Holy Spirit Center. So I feel he will be a very powerful intercessor for us. So we're going to start praying to him in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, this is a very exciting week for Catholics. Tomorrow, we begin the year of faith. And I received, or in my church at St. Gertrude, we had these in the pew, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but what struck me is noted more than once that we should be approaching this year of faith with great joy, excitement, and celebration. And I know we have this election coming up, and a lot of people aren't walking around with great joy in their hearts. And so this is a call to really take a step back and think about how blessed we are to be Christians and to be Catholics. And I believe that this is going to be a wonderful year of an outpouring of God's graces this year, during this year of faith. Something that struck me when I was looking through the Magnificat was this article. Can you, would you mind closing the door? Thanks. Oh. Pope Benedict writes, "Something absolutely central about the faith is that faith has to do and must have to do with forgiving. It aims at leading man to recognize that he is a being that can only find itself in the recognition and transmission of forgiveness." Now, this doesn't mean us forgiving, it means God forgiving us. And I personally understand this more now, because what Mary does is that she helps you to know yourself. She helps you to see your sinfulness. And I promise you there's sins you have that you don't even know about. And so she's very gentle, and she'll start revealing things to you. And then once you confess that and bring it to the Lord and you're healed, then she'll start showing you something else. And a quick way to do this would just be to ask your spouse. But most of us don't want to do that. So, but Mary, I think Mary would be a little more gentle. So,
So I'll just read on a little more here, because this just really struck me as something to ponder, and that faith is a gift, and it must be asked for, and that we can't just say, oh, I'm going to have more faith today. You know, this is something that we have to seek, really and truly, and I finally got that through my head. You know, when we hear Jesus says, your faith has healed you, your faith has saved you, and, you know, it says in Scripture that believe as if you have already received. You know, and how difficult is that for us? We doubt and we worry, and does God really listening sometimes, or does he really care? And so we're not praying with that faith that says, Lord, I'd like for you to do this, and know that it will be done. But what we have to understand, as you all know, it doesn't just happen naturally. It's something that we have to continue to ask for. So it's exciting to me to know that during this year of faith, that the Lord is going to be pouring out faith in abundance upon the world. And so I'm very excited about that. But I'll just read a little bit more here. It says in the Magnificat that Christ's encounter with the paralytic, whom he healed, and says, courage, child, your sins are forgiven, reveals that he sees inside of us and he knows our sins. That is, he knows the worst about us, but he still prefers us and makes us a priority in his life despite our sins, and that he has the power to obliterate our sins and to change the way we live forever. When Jesus speaks those words of forgiveness to the paralytic, faith is born to everyone who's listening, especially the paralytic himself. The paralytic may walk, but all the people's hearts leap and dance for joy that day. For true faith is ordered to God's love and surpasses us and anticipates us. So I just love that. And then there was a quote here that I want to read. Well, this one I can tell you, this was this month, October the 1st. Most of the things I tear out of the Magnificat, I have no idea what year. I should write it down. But this says, the Immaculate Virgin, who conceived without sin, did direct every movement of your most pure... I'm sorry, let me start over. Immaculate Virgin, who conceived without sin, did direct every moment of your most pure heart to God, who was ever the object of your love. Obtain for me the grace to hate sin with my whole heart, and to learn from you to live in perfect resignation to the will of God. So we're going to talk about what this whole, the law of the incarnation and Mary forming Jesus in us a little bit more deeper today, and what that actually means. But it is about dying to self. And we talked about that a little bit already. But I just wanted to point that out, that during this year of faith, I heard on Sacred Heart Radio that, you know, we all need to be praying. Again, I always say, take it to prayer rather than just say, I'm going to do this, you know, just like for Lent. But pray about, what can I do during this year of faith, Lord? You know, because as we know, during Lent, we have all these great ideas, what we're going to do, and I'm going to do this and this and this, and then 3 days into it, we've stopped. And a part of that is because we're trying to decide what we want to do rather than asking God what he wants us to do. You'll have a very different Lent if you start praying, Lord, what do you want me to do during Lent? And so those are the things that I can persevere on rather than the ones I think of on my own. So I ask you to do this for the year of faith. And so whatever it is personally, you know, another mass during the week, monthly confession, or even more often than that, reading one page of the Catechism every day this year. You know, the Catechism is so beautiful. Every time I'm able to pick it up, I just can't believe how beautiful it is. Or 10 minutes of Scripture, or that 5 minutes of quiet time. You know, really, let's do something. And then with your family, too, maybe at the dinner table, you know, something, an apologetic point every night, or a decade of the rosary, if you're not praying the family rosary yet. So I just want to encourage you to do that. Also, I have to throw this out, because God has put in my heart to do something, offer something up, make a sacrifice every day between now and the election. And so including my children, like we're not buying ice cream for a month or whatever, you know. And I'm like, oh, should I even bother saying this? And so after the 2-hour meeting yesterday, some lady came up to me and she said, something you said really touched me. And I was thinking, oh, that's great. You know, what could it be? We covered so much. And she's like, I'm going to give up something before the election. So I'm saying it to you, I throw out there to give up something every day if you can. Okay, so let's pick up the book, and we are on what's called Article 2 of Chapter 1. Article 1, we talked about, was St. Louis de Montfort says that Mary was necessary for God in the incarnation of Jesus. Now, we talked about that word necessary because we're going to be seeing that word used a lot over the next few meetings, that Mary was necessary, as if, you know, if you don't properly understand what he's saying, you would think, you know, that God couldn't have done it another way. Well, obviously, he could have, and so we call that a hypothetical necessity. So Article 1 was about that Mary was, quote-unquote, necessary to bring Jesus into the world. That's how God planned it. And then this Article 2 is about that Mary is necessary to sanctify us. So she brought the head. She also brings the body of Christ and sanctifies us with, in union with the Holy Spirit. So that's what this section is about. And she does that in her role as mother and queen. All right, maybe you've never thought of her as mother and queen. Maybe you think of her as one or the other, but through this study, I really do, and I get a lot of joy out of meditating on her sometimes as my mother, and sometimes thinking about her as my powerful queen who will crush Satan's head. You know, I just, like Father Carapi used to say, my mama wears combat boots, and so she's a powerful, mighty queen as well. All right, so if we look at paragraph 22, which is where we are, it says that Mary is necessary to God, in the sanctification of souls. So in other words, God chose that his mother would play a very important role in making us holy. Okay? And maybe we've never thought about that before. But she was chosen by God to help us to receive the graces that we receive, whether we know it or not. Okay, whether you're Catholic or not. All right, and we're going to talk about that. So let's look at 22 as sort of a summary of what we've already talked about and kind of transitions us into this new section here. It says, the conduct which the three persons of the Most Holy Trinity have deigned to pursue in the incarnation and in the first coming of Jesus Christ, they still pursue daily in an invisible manner throughout the whole church. And they will still pursue it even to the consummation of ages in the last coming of Jesus Christ. So this is what we've been talking about. This is Father Gaffney, I believe, coined the term the law of the incarnation, that the Father used Jesus and the Holy Spirit to bring about, I'm sorry, the Father used Mary and the Holy Spirit, yes, to bring about Jesus the first time. That's the same way that he does it now, and that somehow, some way, in the second coming of Jesus, Mary will be used in union with the Holy Spirit. So what struck me, a light bulb kind of went off when I was reading this the other night, is that, as we know, a lot of people don't have any devotion to Mary whatsoever, and they love Jesus, and they follow Jesus, and they do many great things and are holier than I am. So what is this whole thing about having Mary to form Jesus? And something just went off in my head, and it's something that reminded me of something that Father Hugh Gillespie said at that Total Consecration retreat that I went to on July 1st. And he said, you know, what does it really mean to be Christian? You know, and if I asked you that, I'd probably get as many different answers as there are people in this room. So some people might say to follow Christ, to imitate Christ, right? Lots of different answers. But he said, what we have to understand is that to be Christian is to take on the divine nature of God. That grace, as if you remember, we talked about the definition of grace, is not just something God gives us, but it's actually a sharing in his life. And we know that when we get to heaven that we are going to be God-like. We are going to see him as he is, understand him, be able to have the mind of God. We won't be as infinite like he is infinite, but in this life, we begin through grace. You know, how often do we hear, we've heard grace our whole lives, right? But do we understand what a miracle grace is, and that it takes our human nature and turns us in to Christ? And so what dawned on me is so there's many ways that we can receive grace. And let's say you're not Catholic, but you're Christian and you pray. I mean, Christian, we're Christian too, but you know what I'm saying, non-Catholic Christians. So you can obtain grace in many ways, obviously in your baptism, by prayer, through sacrifice, through good works. But if you have Mary formed in you, then you're going to receive more grace. She is going to be able to form you. She is going to be able to share with you the divine nature of God so that you receive as fullness as you can in this life of Christ. And so then you begin to take on the nature of God. You begin to be more patient, more kind, more understanding. You understand what I'm saying? So it's more than just, yes, you don't need devotion to Mary to grow in holiness and to receive grace. But with Mary and with the power of the Holy Spirit overshadowing her in you, then you much more quickly, St. Louis de Montfort talks about it at the end of the book. He talks about how, you know, you can become like Jesus, like a sculptor would, chipping away at the stone. Or you can go through Mary and be poured into a mold, which is the perfect image of Jesus, and arrive at Jesus in you by going into a mold. You understand what I'm saying? So I don't know why. The light bulbs just went off in my mind when I was reading this. I was like, oh my gosh, do we, you know, it's receiving the divine nature through her intercession in a much greater way than if we didn't have her. Okay, so in other words, we can grow holier, faster, quicker, and easier. And I'm all for easy. You know, give me the shortcut. So, okay. Now, I think this is the last Trinitarian part of the book, but it's very deep, and he covers a lot in this. So he starts out in 23, and you'll notice if you look at 23 and 24 and 25, he starts out in God the Father in 23, and then God the Son in 24, and then God the Holy Spirit in 25. So he goes through this cycle two or three times in this section. Okay, so let's begin with 23, God the Father. And this is a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful paragraph. God the Father made an assemblage of all the waters, and he named them sea, mare. He made an assemblage of all his graces, and he called it Mary, Maria. This great God has a most rich treasury in which he has laid up all that he has of beauty and splendor, of rarity and preciousness, including even his own Son. And this immense treasury is none other than Mary, whom the saints have named the treasure of the Lord, out of whose plenitude all men are made rich. So this idea of her being, you know, I used to teach CCD. That was a challenge. Fifth graders. I didn't have kids yet. So like it's hard for me to discipline other people's kids. So I, you know, they just walked all over me. And then I got my own kids and I was able to be a little tougher. But anyway, I remember telling them that even back then, I had been reading this book and I was very devoted to Mary. But like, I would draw a cross and I'd be like, you know, Jesus died and obtained for us all the graces that we need to be saved. But at the bottom of the cross, if you could imagine like a bucket or a reservoir, that bucket is Mary, and she fills up and receives all those graces and then distributes them to us, or that we go to her to obtain the graces. So sometimes they just don't settle down when you want them to. Okay, so just this is a very beautiful image of Mary as a sea of grace. She's as a sea seems infinite to us, so her grace is seemingly infinite. Father Lance Harlow, who wrote the book Echo of God, wrote that water is necessary to sustain our natural life. Mary is necessary to sustain our supernatural life in Christ. So I thought that was a beautiful analogy. But let's go on then. Now this next paragraph, these next two, might sound new to you, but what's very exciting to me this year, having Father Basil Cole, he read all my notes. He's a Dominican priest at St. Gertrude, and he's a theologian, and he's way high up in the Dominican order, which I know I've already told you this, but some people ask me, who's this Father Basil Cole you keep mentioning? So I want to remind you again. And he used to teach Mariology, and I was so excited, and as I go through the book this year, I realize how much he didn't comment on. In other words, it's correct. But one of the things he said was, everything I'm getting ready to tell you is all what the church has always believed. So if it sounds new to you, it's because you've never been taught this. And we have had a famine of, unfortunately, you know, the faith and the true teachings of the church in this generation and the generation before us. So I ask you, you know, with just to pray about these things if they sound really off the wall. But fortunately, I can go forward with great confidence now that Father Basil Cole has told me, oh yes, this is part of the ordinary magisterium. that Mary is, co-redemptrix, mediatrix of all grace, and dispensatrix of all grace. So what we're getting ready to read is the teaching of the church down through the ages, even back to the early church fathers. So I'm going to read you some of that. So it's very exciting to me. And we're going to talk about today, as I mentioned last time, the four Marian dogma and the possible fifth Marian dogma, which is those things I just mentioned. Okay, and I'm going to explain all that to you. What's dogma? How is it different from doctrine? You know, I'm going to go through that whole process just so you'll have a better understanding. But this paragraph 24, we begin with the idea of her being mediatrix of all grace. In other words, all grace passes through her to us, whether we know it or not, whether we know her or not. All grace comes to the world through Mary. Okay, and that's what he says here in paragraph 24. God the Son has communicated to his mother all that he acquired by his life and his death, his infinite merits and his admirable virtues, and he has made her the treasurer of all that his father gave him for his inheritance. It is by her that he applies his merits to his members, and that he communicates his virtues and distributes his graces. She is his mysterious canal. She is his aqueduct, through which he makes his mercies flow gently and abundantly. And I love those words, gently and abundantly. Again, so this might be new to you. Let's look at the first question, and we'll read some quotes of the saints. And I have a couple things here to read in the Magnificat that I came across again. All right, so question number one. There's extra questions up here if you don't have them. And thank you for those who print those off every week. I really appreciate it. Okay, it says, it is in paragraph 24 that we are presented with the idea of Mary as mediatrix of all grace. It is by her that God the Son applies his merits to his members and distributes his graces. She is his mysterious canal. She is his aqueduct through which he makes his mercies flow gently and abundantly. Is this a new concept to you, that Jesus would have all graces come to us through his mother? How is this a logical consequence of Mary's role in the incarnation? I really love that this is logical. And a lot of the Catholic faith, all of it really, is very logical. I remember, was it Father or Dr. Ray, you guys probably heard of Dr. Ray, he's so funny. He said he went in search of every other religion, you know, in college or whatever it was. And he's like, you know, the Catholic faith makes the most sense. So this is one of those things that really, if you think about it, it's logical. Because God does not change. We've already talked about that. He's immutable. His will is immutable. So how is this a logical consequence? Well, if you think about it, Jesus is all grace. He is the divine life. And how did he come to us? Through Mary. It's really that simple. God deigned that we receive the second person of the Trinity, all grace, grace himself, grace personified, through Mary. And so, he continues that. Someone once said, and I don't remember which saint, but Jesus is the head of the church, we're the body, Mary's the neck. Now, she's not the neck like we talked about last time that turns the head, but she is the canal, or whatever word you want to use, where God has all graces flow to us, whether you know her or not, whether you're Christian or not, whatever graces you receive pass through her. This God willed it this way. And what we're going to look at in the next paragraph, which is a little more challenging, I believe, is that she was rewarded. She was given her 2,000 titles. She earned them. You know, God rewards us for our number one humility being, obviously, faith, hope, and love are the theological virtues, but our desire to grow in humility, and he says this many times throughout this book, that it was her reward for her profound humility. As a matter of fact, we're going to read that in the next paragraph. But let me just read a couple of things here about the whole idea of her being mediatrix of all grace. This is in the Magnificat. I have written awesome at the top of this. And I don't know what year. It just says Tuesday the 22nd, so sorry. It says, our grace that we receive from God is fundamentally Trinitarian because it comes from the Blessed Trinity. Our grace is Christian because it comes from Christ. Our grace is Marian because God, in fact, uses Mary as an instrument of his love. Therefore, we can say the fact that we are linked to Jesus through Mary, just as we are linked to the Father through Jesus, is the most deeply inscribed characteristic of our grace. We need to understand the superabundance of love and mercy poured out by means of instruments. St. Thomas Aquinas tells us that whenever God uses a supplementary mediation, it is always in order for mercy to go further. It is in view of the superabundance of his mercy. God needs no instruments. The Blessed Trinity has no need of instruments. Nevertheless, the Blessed Trinity uses the priesthood to bring us Jesus and uses Jesus to save us, making Jesus the mediator of grace. Jesus continues the superabundance by giving us Mary so that she may truly be the mediatrix of grace. St. Louis de Montfort tries to show, at a theological level, Jesus' deep intention of using Mary so that his own mediation, his priestly mediation, might overflow, so that the grace he gives to us, which is already a superabundance of grace, might assume an even deeper dimension in Mary's heart. Jesus does not need Mary. If he uses Mary, it is in view of this superabundance. It can be no other way, otherwise he would not use her. Thus it is in view of an even greater fullness of grace. It is so that our grace might go to the end in the demands of grace, so that certain aspects of grace, which could not otherwise come to fruition, might blossom in the depths of our hearts. So I know that's kind of long and wordy, but basically what he's saying is, and it's hard for us to comprehend, but it's a mystery, but because Jesus is everything, you know, and his superabundance of grace comes from him. But for some people, to go to a mother, to pray to her, it might touch a part of their heart that wouldn't be touched normally. You see, Jesus has this whole plan. You know, it's a family. Some people relate better to their father. Some people relate better to their mother. And then we have brothers and sisters. We have saints. We have angels. And so it's not just me and Jesus. Jesus is enough. But God, because of his great love and mercy, wants to try to get to the deepest parts of our hearts. And sometimes that's through a mother. So it's not taking away from him. And let me just read what the Catechism says about this. If you look at Catechism 969 and 970, I'm going to read those. And I have a lot of reading to do today, so I'm sorry if you can just hang with me. It's kind of long. I should have told everybody to bring their catechisms so you could follow along. 969 and 970, if you have your catechism with you. And what I'm reading this to you, a couple things in the catechism, to show you that mediatrix and even co-redemptrix are in the catechism. Okay, so this isn't something that St. Louis de Montfort made up in 1700. Okay, so this is 969. It says, the motherhood of Mary in the order of grace continues uninterruptedly from the consent which she loyally gave at the Annunciation, and which she can sustain without wavering beneath the cross until the eternal fulfillment of all the elect. Taken up to heaven, she did not lay aside this saving office, but by her manifold intercession continues to bring us the gifts of eternal salvation. Therefore, the Blessed Virgin is invoked in the Church under the titles of Advocate, Helper, Benefactress, and Mediatrix. And then this is important, because a lot of people say, but Jesus is the one and only mediator, and he is. He is with the Father. Okay? And that's what we need to realize, is that he is. We cannot get to the Father except through Jesus. But Jesus is also God. And so Mary's a mediatrix with Jesus. And it's not the same kind of mediatrix of redemption. What Pope John Paul calls her is a mediatrix of intercession. Just like at the wedding feast at Cana, she brings the needs of her children to her son. Now, he knows our needs, right? But again, it's a superabundance of his sharing his divine life and rewarding his mother and giving her a share in bringing us to him, our needs to him, all right? God knows our needs, Father Basil Cole said. He knows. But it's again, allowing us to offer our sufferings for souls. What a great gift that is. Think about that. Our suffering is not wasted. Our suffering is powerful when united with the cross. Is that not a tremendous gift that God has given to us, that we can actually help save souls, get souls out of purgatory? So you see, if he's allowing us to participate in this great gift of bringing grace to souls, of course this is what he's doing with his mother, okay? So I'll read what Pope John Paul II explains it beautifully here. This is in the Catechism, but this is also from Vatican II, and this is 970 in the Catechism. It says, Mary's function as Mother of Men in no way obscures or diminishes this unique mediation of Christ, but rather shows its power. The Blessed Virgin's influence on men flows forth from the superabundance of the merits of Christ, rests on his mediation, depends entirely on it, and draws all its power from it. No creature could ever be counted alongside the incarnate Word and Redeemer, but just as the priesthood of Christ is shared in various ways by both the ministers, the priests, and the faithful, we're priest, prophet, and king when we're baptized, and is the goodness of God is radiated in different ways among his creatures, so also the unique mediation of the Redeemer does not exclude, but rather gives rise to a manifold cooperation, which is but a sharing in this one source. So again, I think it's just helpful to think about what he gives us the ability to do by our prayers and our sacrifices. If we can help, of course, she has these tremendous powers and responsibilities. So one more thing here from the, I'll try to summarize this one because I thought it was beautiful. And this was this month in the Magnificat, but it says something about, like, you know, a lamp is a mediator of light. You know, we don't just look at light. The light comes to us through something. And so, you know, Mary is, I don't know if any of you remember reading this, it was this month, and I didn't tear that one out. Well, I did, but I didn't bring it. But it's like, you know, she's like the lamp where we look at to receive the light of Christ. You know, she's not the light, but she funnels the light to us. Okay, so here's one more I'll read, and I won't read this whole thing because I saw some glassy eyes yesterday when I was reading it. But it says, not only is the admirable heart of the Savior's mother an ocean of grace, this is what we just read, an ocean of grace, containing and almost infinitely surpassing all the graces in the church, triumphant and militant, it is also their source and their origin. As the Eternal Father chose Mary from all eternity, that through her we might receive him who is the first author and principle of grace, so did God likewise choose her, that through his handmaid we might receive all the graces proceeding from that first source. As God deigned to give us a Savior only through the Virgin's consent, so did he eternally decree to grant any gift or grace only through Mary. God wishes to have everything through Mary's hands, to give us everything through Mary's hands, says St. Bernard. Okay, I'll stop reading. All right, so let's go on, because the next paragraph, I think, is the one that is a little more challenging. Okay, so, because this paragraph sort of makes it sound like she just stands there, right, and grace has just passed through her. But she actually has a role, okay? And that's this next paragraph here, again, is church doctrine. It's the belief of the church down through the centuries, which may shock you, because I didn't learn this growing up at all. Okay, so 25. To Mary, his faithful spouse, God the Holy Ghost, has communicated his unspeakable gifts, and he has chosen her to be the dispenser of all he possesses, in such wise that she distributes to whom she wills, as much as she wills, and when she wills, all his gifts and graces. The Holy Ghost gives no heavenly gift to men which she does not have passed through her virginal hands. Such has been the will of God, who has willed that we should have everything through Mary, so that, and here's the underline this, she who impoverished, humbled, and who hid herself, even unto the abyss of nothingness, by her profound humility, her whole life long, should now be enriched and exalted and honored by the Most High. And then this sentence too. Such are the sentiments of the church and the Holy Fathers. So let's look at question number two. Because you may have had this question going through your mind. Number 25, St. Louis de Montfort takes it a step further and says that not only is Mary the mediatrix of all grace, but she is also the dispensatrix of all grace, deciding when and to whom graces should be distributed. Is this taking it too far? Shouldn't God be the one to make these decisions? What key points does St. Louis de Montfort make in paragraph 27 to help us understand this? Well, first of all, and I know you know this, but God does make the decisions, all right? Mary simply carries out God's will. God's will does not change. Mary does not change. She's not over here making decisions. Even at the wedding feast at Cana, when Jesus says, "My time has not yet arrived," he hadn't been told yet by God that his time. But he told Mary. God told Mary. He just hadn't told Jesus yet. And we don't understand because Jesus is God. But, you know, we see in Scripture that Jesus goes deep into prayer every night, all night long. And he says, "I'm only doing the will of the Father, not my own." You know, he even says, in my humanity, I might have done it differently. You know, it's hard for us to understand. But he just daily lives in the present moment. You know, he's just like, "Okay, Father." He didn't wake up this morning and he wasn't told by God last night, "Today's the day." You know, so that's all he meant. So it wasn't that Mary's changing God's plan. "Oh, now you got to start now." So it's just something that we don't want to get confused on, as if, you know, Mary has some role over here that's apart from God. Okay. And even though it may sound that way as we're reading, Mary, the angels, the saints, everything they do, all their intercessory power is in God, with God, through God, and for God. Okay. So don't be confused about that when we start applying these powers to Mary, okay? However, as we have said, God does want to reward us. He will reward us. And let's look at Scripture, and well, you can't, unless you brought your Bible with you, I can tell you the verse. But a couple things I want to comment on, even before I answer the question. And that is that we see this whole idea of after we die and get to heaven, God willing, depending how we lived our life, we're going to have responsibilities in heaven, and you thought you could rest. And I'm going to read to you. This is in Scripture. Now, this is a mystery. I don't pretend to have any idea what this even means, but I just want to point this out to you. I'm going to read to you. You know the stories. I'm not going to read it to you, but Matthew 25, and this is verses 14 to 30, is the story of the talents, where you get one, you get five, you get 10. Okay. So at the end of that story, that's what I'm going to read to you. It's 14 to 30. At the end of that story, and you've heard this a million times, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Since you were faithful in small matters, I will give you great responsibilities." This is the end of his life. "Come, share your master's joy." So what's he talking about? Well, you know, I thought about it, and the saints are patrons of this and that, right? And it's a lot of times based on how they live their life, something they did down here that was virtuous or meritorious or heroic, they're the patron saint of this or that, right? And they have special intercessory power. And they're not acting outside of God, but we all know that. We pray novenas to them for things, for this or that, right? So if they were given intercessory power, what is the queen, you know, who was perfect, Mary, in her life? So here's another one, just to show you it's in the Bible more than once. And even a couple weeks ago, St. Paul says, you know, we will judge angels. We will judge men in heaven. And the just will judge, you know. So what's he talking about? You know, we can't really know, but we're not just going to be sitting around. Doesn't sound like it. All right, so here's one more. And this is Luke 12, 39 to 48, and Jesus says, "Who then is the faithful and prudent steward whom the master will put in charge of his servants to distribute the food allowance at the proper time? Blessed is the servant whom his master on arrival finds doing so. Truly I say to you, he will put him in charge of all his property." So we don't know exactly what that means, but I just think it's helpful to see. And then my sister-in-law, who's, you're watching this video from Northern Ohio, when my brother passed away, she sent me this link, or I'm sorry, a homily, Father Dave, and I don't know his name, but it was Stewardship Sunday. And he was saying the same thing. So I was like so excited because it's like a priest is saying this, if I can find it. He said, when we are in heaven, we will continue to be the same sort of stewards that we were on earth, only more so and perfectly. The better steward you are on earth, the more God will entrust you in heaven. It's interesting. You know, have you ever thought about this? So, Mary, being perfect, in every possible way, we shouldn't be surprised that God would give her great rewards, great responsibilities in heaven. Okay, so in answer to question number two, let's look at paragraph 27. I'm going to skip 26 anyway because it's basically just saying, he's basically saying, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail because I believe that you'll believe what I'm saying, basically. And all right, so 27. How does this help us answer this question? Inasmuch as grace perfects nature and glory perfects grace, and I'll explain what that means in just a minute, it is certain that our Lord is still in heaven as much the Son of Mary as he was on earth, and that consequently he has retained the obedience and submission of the most perfect child toward the best of all mothers. But we must take great pains not to conceive this dependence as any abasement or imperfection in Jesus Christ. For Mary is infinitely below her Son, who is God, and therefore she does not command him as a mother here below would command her child, who is below her. Mary, being altogether transformed into God by grace and by the glory which transforms all the saints into him, asks nothing, wishes nothing, does nothing contrary to the eternal and immutable will of God. When we read then in the writings of Saints Bernard, Bernardine, Bonaventure, and others, that in heaven and on earth, everything, even God himself, is subject to the Blessed Virgin, they mean that the authority which God has been well pleased to give her is so great that it seems, circle the words that I emphasize, I'm doing that so that you'll circle them, it seems as if she had the same power as God, and that her prayers and petitions are so powerful with God that they always pass for commandments with his majesty, who never resists the prayer of his dear mother, because she is always what? Humble and conformed to his will. Okay, and then he gives us an example of Moses, who wasn't perfect. If Moses, by the force of his prayer, stayed or placated the anger of God against the Israelites in a manner so powerful that the Most High and the infinitely merciful Lord, being unable to resist him, told him to let him alone that he might be angry with and punish that rebellious people, what must we not, with much greater reason, think of the prayer of the humble Mary, that worthy mother of God, which is more powerful with his majesty than the prayers and intercessions of all the angels and the saints, both in heaven and on earth. So, again, he's showing us that Mary obviously has no power of her own. It's everything that she has is obviously a sharing in the divine life. Now, the only power that she has, which we all have, is our free will. So that's something that Father Basil Cole wanted to make sure that everybody knows, that that is what we have and what we own. And that's a gift to us, is our free will. So Mary also had a free will. She was not programmed like a robot and just automatically said fiat. And it was her free will to choose that. And so that's merit. So she merited these great responsibilities in heaven. So he's showing us then that Mary is a mother and that mothers give orders. But of course, we don't think of this as our mothers down here where we're tainted by, at least I am, my sinfulness, and I get angry, and I'm impatient, and I'm not consistent, all these things. So Mary doesn't command him in that way, but he obeys perfectly the fourth commandment, as we've talked about, and so he honors and obeys his mother, who never tells him to do anything that is outside the will of God, okay? So there's nothing here that is, it sounds when you first read it, maybe a little like, wow, what's he saying here? Even God is subject to Mary. What's he talking about? But obviously, what we know is that Mary acts within completely the will of God. And everything she has been a gift to her. It's been a reward to her. So also, for you and I, then, and I just want to reread St. Faustina real quick about humility, because humility is a hard thing. But darn it, we got to do it. we just got to pray that litany of humility, and it's a pain because then you get humiliated. We just have to say thank you, Lord, for that little humiliation, and it's hard. But that is where that last sentence, humble and conform to his will. By being humble, we become automatically more conformed to his will, because humility means dying to yourself. And so if you die to yourself, you turn more and do the will of the Lord. So humility helps you. And I just want to read you one more time because this is so powerful. In St. Faustina's diary, paragraph 1306, I'm just going to read part of it. And I read it last time or the time before, and it's one of my favorite paragraphs because I don't think we really understand it, how important humility is and how powerful it is. And we try to avoid it, you know, and we don't even mean to, but as I said back then, and we'll talk more about humility as the year goes on, but it really does bring a lot of happiness to you. I mean, it's hard at first, and it's always hard to grow in humility, but it really, it sets you free of yourself. And you walk around in a new freedom, you know, because you're not bogged down with your own selfishness as much. And so it really does make your life happier if you grow in humility. So it's worth the challenge. It's worth the hard work. But here's what St. Faustina says. The floodgates of heaven are open to a humble soul. And a sea of graces flow down upon her. Oh, how beautiful is a humble soul. This is 1306. God, and this is part I want you to hear, because sometimes we pray and we feel like our prayers aren't being answered and we just, you know, it's hard sometimes. Here's what St. Faustina says. God refuses nothing to a humble soul. She is all-powerful and influences the destiny of the whole world. So you've got a month here before the election to get humble. God raises such a soul up to his very throne. And the more she humbles herself, the more God stoops down to her, pursuing her with his graces and accompanying her at every moment with his omnipotence. So I just want to encourage you not to be afraid to grow in humility and ask for this gift. Ask for this. Because everything is a gift. You know, I heard a homily, St. Gertrude, I don't remember who did it, but Father James Sullivan, some of you know him. He was talking about, you know, sometimes you'll go to confession and then you'll come out and you'll say, I'm going to try harder. I'm going to really try this week. And as if we can do it, you know. And what we should be doing when we come out of confession is saying, Lord, will you give me the grace to do this or that? You see, and I think that we have to really start noticing this about ourselves. And not to take away from our free will, but what our free will is, and this came to me too, our free will is a cooperation with grace. Our free will is the decision to cooperate with grace. You know, we can decide to cooperate with it or not, but we have to ask for it. And faith, growing in faith is something you should be asking for every day, especially during this year of faith. I think you're going to get a ton of it. And I'm really excited about that because, as Jesus says, your faith has healed you. Your faith has saved you. When you start having more faith, then you start believing in what you're asking for. Because, you know, I think a lot of times we pray and we just don't believe. We don't believe that God is going to answer. You know, we just don't have faith. Pope Benedict, in his wisdom, has called for the year of faith because there has been a monumental absence of faith in the world. It's dropped off, you know, and he's calling for us to increase this gift. But it's a gift, and it's a gift you can't get on your own. You can't just roll up your sleeves, and that's actually a heresy called Pelagianism, is I'm just going to roll up my sleeves and try harder to have more faith, you know, or to be more patient. Now, of course, we do have to cooperate with grace, but go ahead. I can't hear you.
Do you think it's because you feel
that? Yeah. Yeah, that right. He's right. And as we're going to read here coming up in the next meeting especially, is so exciting that Mary, we're not worthy and we're sinful and we're conscious of the things we've done. And we, you know, the devil's always there reminding us of what we've done. But Mary wants to come in, like we said, and get us to go and seek healing of all of that and be healed of our pride and our vanity and our worry and our, you know, feelings of not being worthy or feelings of being too worthy or whatever it is. You know, she comes in and she gets all that gunk out so that then it's all about surrender. We surrender all of that over so that then she can fill us with the divine life. So yeah, you're right. I mean, we do feel that way. But what helps those feelings of unworthiness is an increase of faith. And really, ask for an increase of faith. God will always answer that prayer. I ask at every Mass, at every consecration, and I'm just like, bring it on, Lord. Give me a lot of faith. Faith, hope, and love. Because those are the foundational virtues. I mean, that, and once you grow in faith, hope, and love, everything else just sort of grows with it. So that's what Mary's all about. That's why this is such an exciting year. It's so much more exciting than we realize. I mean, it's awesome. It's like God is throwing us this life preserver, this year of faith. You know, we got to grab on and really beg the Lord to increase your faith. Okay, let's go on because I'll make sure that we answer, though, question number two. Okay. Again, it's humility. I'm sorry. God trusts her is another thing. If you think about like a king and a queen on earth, you know, or even a husband and a wife, you know, like someone said this one year, and I thought it was really cute. You know, the husband earns the money, but the wife spends it. You know, I don't go and ask my husband every time I'm going to buy something, is it okay with you? You know, every time. He just trusts me, you know, to his own, whatever. Just kidding. to his own peril. That's what I'm really for. No, but, you know, it's just like in a kingdom, the queen is usually the one that is more out interacting with the people, giving the gifts to the people, and she's not running every minute and saying, you know, the king trusts that she's going to make decisions that are going to be in alignment with his will. So it's the same thing with the Blessed Mother, the queen. She's the queen. So he's given her a certain amount of, only way I can describe it is as a reward for her humility, which is how he describes it. He gives her, and it's, so it's her, to her great honor and joy that she, and her only goal is the same as his, is to save us. So she distributes, she's not like she's being stingy with graces or something. Oh, well, I'm going to give some to you, but not you. It's not that kind of a thing. I think of St. Catherine Laboure at the Blessed Mother appeared to her, the miraculous medal. And there's rays, you know, that Our Lady of Grace, it's one of my favorite statues or pictures of Mary. And she's got rays coming from her fingers in that apparition. And St. Catherine Laboure says, what are those? And she says, they're graces for the world. And then a few of her fingers, there's no grace, there's no rays. And she says, why aren't there rays there? And she's like, well, these are the grace that people aren't asking for. Like, you know, she's basically saying, I have all this grace to pass out. I'm the reservoir, you know. And I have, and so some of it I give freely, but some of it, because of God's mysterious plan, we have to ask for. We have to go get it, you know, for ourselves and others. And I think about that my mom and dad and grandparents, that they got all this grace for me to be here. And I didn't even get it myself. But now I'm trying to go get it for my kids, you know. And so that's how it works. We get grace for each other, you know. And that's how total consecration works. And we'll get into that more later in the year. But what's so great about total consecration is everything you do obtains grace for the whole world. Your thoughts, your words, your actions, everything, not just your prayers and sacrifices, but everything, your duties of your state. So that everything you do becomes a prayer that we give to Mary, that she uses and then multiplies and goes out and saves souls. And we won't know until we get to heaven. But St. Louis de Montfort describes that there will be a vast multitude of people that through your total consecration to Mary, she was able to help save. Through your yes, through your fiat, through your surrender. So it's amazing. It's an amazing gift to be able to participate in this. I mean, it really is. It's life-changing. And she will get to work on changing you. Okay? All right. So make sure I don't miss anything here. One of the things that Father Gaffney says, again, because Mary distributes the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And we've talked about this, the seven gifts that you received in confirmation, charismatic gifts, all the different gifts that the Holy Spirit has, you will begin to notice and you'll begin asking more for them and you'll believe confidently that you'll receive them. Father Gaffney says, Mary is the inseparable spiritual spouse, as we've discussed, of the Holy Spirit. For he espoused her at the incarnation, to which she fully consented. Therefore, she is his spouse and his intimate associate in all the works of grace wrought by the Holy Spirit. So, this is pretty interesting. This is St. Faustina's diary, paragraph 31. Jesus says to St. Faustina, who is living, He tells her in paragraph 31, do whatever you wish. Distribute graces as you will, to whom you will, and when you will. Word for word, what we're reading in this book. That is amazing. And so he's telling her, I will honor your requests to give graces to whoever you want, whenever you want, because she was extremely humble. If you read her diary, humble, humility. So, you know, if he's saying that to her, imagine the Blessed Mother. So, all right, let's move on. Just make sure we get through everything here. I don't want to forget anything. There's so much. Okay, let's talk about mediatrix, dispensatrix, co-redemptrix, and the dogma, okay? But before we do that, I just want to read you one more thing in the catechism, because I read to you how mediatrix is in there, right? Well, so is co-redemptrix, but not the word co-redemptrix, but the definition of co-redemptrix, okay? And I just want to read you that because I think it's important that you know that it's in the catechism. Remember, co means with, not equal. Let me, you know, if this dogma comes out, there's going to be mass confusion because everybody's going to think co means equal. And we know that we're going to be busy telling people, no, no, no. Co comes from the Latin word cum, which means with. Okay, so I just want to read this to you really quickly. This is paragraph 964. He says, Mary's role in the church is inseparable from her union with Christ and flows directly from it. The union of the mother with the son in the work of salvation is made manifest from the time of Christ's virginal conception up to the time of his death. It is made manifest above all at the hour of his passion. Okay, and we read this about how she stood at the foot of the cross. Now listen, what this is actually the words of John Paul II. This is in Vatican II in the document Lumen Gentium, but it's also in the catechism. It's so important. They put it in the catechism too. Okay, here's what he says. Thus, the Blessed Virgin advanced in her pilgrimage of faith and faithfully persevered in her union with her son unto the cross. And there she stood in keeping with the divine plan, enduring with her only begotten son the intensity of his suffering, joining herself with his sacrifice in her mother's heart, and lovingly consenting to the immolation of this victim born of her. So right there is what the definition of co-redemptrix, that her sufferings united with his helped bring about our salvation, because God willed it that way. The sword shall pierce your heart is where we're told that she's going to participate in the redemption. Didn't need to, but as I said, we do too. Our little sufferings, our little swords in the heart help redeem our friends and family members. Thanks be to God. It's not wasted. Okay, let's really quickly, I'll try to make this quick. What's dogma? First of all, there are four Marian dogma. There's not that many dogma. Let me backtrack. There are. There's two ways that the church normally gives us dogma, and that is what you're probably familiar with, the Chair of Peter, and through an ecumenical council. And that's the one I didn't know about. Okay, but let me back up. Dogma is a subset of doctrine, okay? Doctrine is all the teachings of the church, everything, okay? And the definition I have here is doctrine is all the teachings of the church based on scripture and sacred tradition as interpreted by the magisterium. Okay, so everything we believe as Catholics, that's doctrine. Now, what dogma is given to us by the church when there's confusion about a doctrine, okay? So, for instance, back in the 300s, there were groups of Catholics who were debating whether Mary was the mother of just the humanity of Jesus, or was she the mother of God, mother of the divinity. And there were sects saying, you know, heretical groups, or at the time it wasn't heresy because people didn't know. It was so confusing. You know, it made sense that she wouldn't be the mother of his divinity. So they called an ecumenical council and gave us the first Marian dogma, which was, I think I have. Oh, yeah. The first Marian dogma, which was Theotokos, which means God-bearer, which means mother of God. And that was the first, and that's called a dogma. You see, the church defined it definitively. Now, I know some of you in here aren't Catholic, infallibly, and a lot of non-Catholics think that we think the Pope is infallible and perfect and everything he says and does. And I'm going to read to you what the Catechism says, because the infallibility is a charism, okay, of the Holy Spirit. A charism is a gift of the Spirit to build up the church. Catechism 2003, if you want to look that up, we'll be looking at it later in the year. But 2003 describes what a charism is. A charism is a gift of the Spirit given to the members of the body of Christ to build up the church. Okay, they're different from the seven gifts. The seven gifts are to build up us. Knowledge, fortitude, you know, give us strength, fear of the Lord, piety, wisdom and understanding. But there's a whole other set of gifts called the charismatic gifts. Okay, and they're all throughout Scripture. St. Paul mentions 20 or 30 of them. The majority of them are ordinary gifts like teaching, administration, leadership, you know, care for the poor, care for the elderly, care for the young, whatever gift you have. We don't think of it often, but that is, there are many parts, right, but one body, and we're going to look at this later in the year, but I'm just bringing it up now to describe to you what a charism is. So infallibility is what's called one of the extraordinary charisms of the Spirit. So some of the gifts of the Spirit are miraculous, like some people have the gift of healing, all right, and other gifts. So I want to read that because I think it's important to understand, even for some Catholics, what's this whole infallibility thing. All right, this is paragraph 889 and 890, okay? So infallibility is given to the Pope of the Catholic Church in the matters of faith and morals. Okay, we don't think the Pope's infallible when he tells us what his favorite restaurant is, or if he gives advice on a sporting event, or, you know, and that's what some people really think, that we just bow down to his every word. And so it's important that we understand. And I want to read this to you because I think it's very, what's the truth? It says in 889, in order to preserve the church and the purity of the faith handed on by the apostles, Christ, who is the truth, willed to confer on her a share in his own infallibility. By a supernatural sense of faith, the people of God, under the guidance of the church's living magisterium, unfailingly adheres to this faith. The mission of the magisterium, which is the teaching body of the Catholic Church, is linked to the definitive nature of the covenant established by God with his people in Christ. It is this magisterium's task to preserve God's people from deviations and defections, and to guarantee them the objective possibility of professing the true faith without error. Thus, the pastoral duty of the magisterium is aimed at seeing to it that the people of God abides in the truth that liberates. To fulfill the service, Christ endowed the church's shepherds with the charism of infallibility in the matters of faith and morals. Okay? So, dogma. All right. There's what's called the ordinary magisterium, and then there's what's called the supreme magisterium. Okay? The ordinary magisterium is everything the church has always believed down through the ages for all times, like, for instance, all life is sacred. Okay? We don't need an ecumenical council to tell us that. Pope doesn't need to sit in the chair of Peter, which I'll describe what that is in a minute. We just know that. It's always been accepted. Some people think there should be. There's so much confusion. But that's simple and straightforward. That all life is sacred. Okay, that's just one example of something that's part of the ordinary magisterium. All right, and then what the supreme magisterium is exactly set up to define these dogmas. Okay, so there's two different forms of the supreme magisterium. The first is what we call the chair of Peter. This is rarely used, but it's when the Pope, there's actually a chair, he sits in it, and he has to say, I am infallibly stating a dogma. He did this twice with the Marian dogma, all right? The Immaculate Conception, and because it was being debated, and there was confusion among the faithful, and that's often why dogma are, why they do this, just to clear up all the confusion. So that was in 1854 by Pope Pius IX. Okay? And the second time that happened, as again, as I said, it hasn't happened very often. I don't have the numbers, but this is rare that the Pope does this. And the second one was the Assumption of the Blessed Mary in 1950, of all things. Can you imagine? So it wasn't like the church just started believing in the Assumption of Mary in 1950, and that was Pope Pius XII. And some of you were living at that time, and maybe you, I have to ask my parents, did you like have a big party that night or what? You know, that must have been so exciting, because I can't imagine if they came out with the Fifth Marian Dogma, it would just be like, oh my gosh, you know, like the greatest thing ever. But so what happened, so the Assumption in 1950 was part of the ordinary magisterium up until that point. You know, church always believed it, part of the ordinary magisterium that Mary was assumed into heaven after her death. But in 1950, it became dogma. All right, and I'm going to read to you the definition in the catechism of what dogma is, even though I've given you a general idea. And that is Catechism 88 and 89. 88, what's that? 1950, yeah. And the first Marian year followed that in 1954, somebody told me yesterday. Okay, 88 and 89. The church's magisterium exercises the authority it holds from Christ to the fullest extent when it defines dogmas. That is, when it proposes truths contained in divine revelation or having a necessary connection with them, and the form in a form obliging the Christian people to an irrevocable adherence of faith. In other words, we have to believe. You know, we have to believe doctrine too, but it's a stronger statement of faith to believe in dogma. There is a connection between our spiritual life and the dogmas. Dogmas are lights along the path. So, if something's confusing, they shine a flashlight on it and show us and help us see it. That's what dogmas are. They help us understand something that there's been, you know, a lot of debate or something on a certain issue of faith and morals. It has to be faith and morals. You know, some issue about something else, they're not going to have a dogma about. Okay, they illuminate it and make it secure. If our life is upright, open to truth, our intellect and heart will be open to and welcome the light shed by the dogma of faith. And I heard someone say that people who are truth seekers, no matter who they are, what religion they are, come into the church when dogmas are pronounced. Because if you're open to the truth, that's what happens. Because it's the truth. And if you're open to the truth, you're going to accept it. You know, that's why we can't be afraid to speak the truth. Pope Benedict has really been talking about this lately. You know, speak the truth, and if the person isn't going to accept it now, at least grace follows your words, and maybe that the seed is planted, but it won't be watered until later when they hear it from somebody else or something. But we cannot be afraid to speak the truth. You know, Pope Benedict has been talking about this a lot lately in the last month or two, and saying that we're going to be called all kinds of, you know, intolerant and everything else, but speak the truth in love with gentleness and kindness. Sometimes you have to be bold, but in general, you're not going to convince anyone of anything unless you're meek and humble. You know, people put a wall up when you're not, so we have to be careful about being angry, you know. Okay. All right, so let me tell you the four Marian dogma now. I've told you three of them. Well, there's one that comes in between. So the first one was the Immaculate Theotokos. And that came, let me tell you where that came from. Theotokos, Mary, Mother of God, well, I already told you. It was an ecumenical council, and it was the Council of Ephesus in the year 431. Okay, so that was the first one. The second one, actually, this one is kind of an exception, and that is Mary's perpetual virginity. Now, that is actually part of the ordinary magisterium, something that's always been taught. It was part of the baptismal formula. But it was referred to implicitly in the Council of Lateran in the year 649. So the Pope actually discussed it, and they talked about it. But it wasn't like, this is dogma, because it just had always been believed. It wasn't being debated at the time, in the Catholic, when things are being debated, I mean within Catholic circles, not outside of Catholic circles, but the church is concerned about, you know, misinformation in Catholic circles. So those are the four that we have now. Theotokos, Mother of God, Perpetual Virginity, the Immaculate Conception, and the Assumption of the Blessed Mother. Now, this one that people are calling the Fifth Marian Dogma is very complex. As you know, it's Mary as co-redemptrix. I'll repeat them. Okay, so I have to think. I'm tired. Mother of God.
Could you say what is?
And the year and all that. Okay. Okay, sure. So the first one, the earliest one, was Mary, Mother of God, or Theotokos is another word for that. And that was the Council of Ephesus in the year 431. Okay, in the year 431. Okay. The second one was Mary's Perpetual Virginity. And that was referred to in the Council of Lateran in 649. Okay. The third one, am I going too fast? Okay. Is the Immaculate Conception in 1854 by Pope Pius IX. And that one was from the chair of Peter, yes. He, Pius IX, sat in the chair and said, this is infallible teaching. And then the fourth one, also chair of Peter by Pope Pius XII, was the Assumption of Mary in 1950. Okay, now something interesting about this fifth one is that I believe it was in 1950. For the dogma of the Assumption, Rome received petitions, millions of petitions, to proclaim this as dogma. As a matter of fact, they received, what I have here is 8 million petitions over a period of 95 years. Well, this fifth Marian dogma, thanks to Mark Miravalle, who's a professor at Franciscan Steubenville, in just 15 years, there have been 7 million petitions for the fifth Marian dogma of her as co-redemptrix, mediatrix of all grace, and advocate. And the reason dispensatrix isn't in there is because the church combines the two. Although they are distinct, as Father Basil Cole said, you can't be dispensatrix without being mediatrix. But the role of dispensatrix is included in her role as mediatrix. So it's co-redemptrix, mediatrix, and advocate, which just means intercessor, all in one. And a lot of people thought Pope John Paul II, the Marian Pope, would do this. And he didn't, and it could be because he was a bridge builder, and he was ecumenical, and he reached out, you know, to all people, and perhaps throwing this dogma in at that time wouldn't have been a good idea. But I don't know. In God's perfect timing, if it's His will, it will happen. Probably in this age of Mary, at some point, maybe Pope Benedict. He's pretty bold, you know. He might do it. So, if you want to send a petition to Rome, I have, and a lot of 500 bishops have done it. Mother Teresa, as I said, and lots of people, her sisters. So maybe I'll just send that out, and then you're free to print it off and sign your name. And if you're interested, yes. You know, I don't know how many they need, but it just shows that we want it, the people, you know. But what is so wonderful for me to be able to say to you is that this is part of the ordinary magisterium of the church. That is awesome. You know, I had way back when I started, and I didn't know all of this, that what I've learned since, a lady said, you know, I think I'll just wait until that's dogma, you know, before I read this book even. And I didn't know what to say. I'm like, well, okay, you know, that's fine. That's what you want to do. But I wish I could have said at the time, but it is what the church teaches. You don't have to wait on the dogma. And I'm going to show you that right now by reading you some quotes of some of the saints, all right? And I realize we've only read 3 paragraphs, so I got to hurry. All right, here's a few. Now, St. Maximian Kolbe, of course, being in our lifetime, many of us, well, not mine, I guess he died before I was born, but you know what I'm saying, last century, he brought back, I guess you could say, the whole idea of Mary being the spouse of the Holy Spirit, okay? And someone was asking me about that, Terry. I just ordered a book, and I cannot wait to read it, called Mary and the Life of the Spirit. But it's all about her and the Holy Spirit being united and being the spouse. But St. Maximian Kolbe was one who wrote a lot about that. And here's what he says, and I love this. He said, now this is about her being mediatrix, okay, and dispensatrix. He says, the Blessed Mother is not like a mail carrier. I love that. So she isn't like, here's the grace, thank you, God, here you go. You know, she does not receive graces from God for an appointed purpose so that she might use them in one way or another. The Immaculate Virgin receives graces from God for her own exclusive property, and she dispenses them to us how she wills, to whom she wills, and in as much as she wills, for these are her own. So he's saying that she is truly a decision maker, but not outside of the will of God, obviously. And it's a reward, okay? As the mother of Jesus, our Savior, Mary was co-redemptrix of the human race. As the spouse of the Holy Spirit, she shares in the distribution of graces. Oh, so I see. So as participating with Jesus, she's co-redemptrix. As participating with the Holy Spirit, she's dispensatrix. So that's cool. I never thought of it that way. Okay, even though it's in the book. Okay, anyway, I'm kind of slow. Light bulbs go off. That's why it's good to do this year after year, because something else will, you know, keeps going off in my mind. All right, St. Alphonsus Liguori, who is a wonderful Marian saint. Feast day, August 1st. I always honor the Marian saints on their feast days. I always beg them for a greater devotion to Mary and all this. So I encourage you to do that. But he's one. August 1st is his feast. And he wrote a book called The Glories of Mary, which is just fabulous. He says, St. Alphonsus Liguori, if I can find it, just lost my spot. He says, God, who gave us Jesus Christ, wills that all graces that have been, that are, and that will be dispensed to men to the end of the world through the merits of Jesus Christ should be dispensed by the hands and through the intercession of Mary. I forget what year he was. But this is the early church, St. Ephrem, in the year 373. He says, I call upon you, Mary, mediatrix of the world. In one of his sermons, he calls her the dispensatrix of all gifts, the mediatrix of the whole world. St. Peter Julian Aimard explains it this way. Mankind was unworthy to receive the word directly from God, so Mary was our mediatrix in the incarnation. And she continues to exercise that function, just like we were saying. No one comes to the knowledge of Jesus Christ fully and embraces his holy law except through her. No one obtains the saving gift of faith except by her prayers. Her mission, to which she is ever faithful, is to give us Jesus. He must be received from her hands, and in vain do we seek him elsewhere. So that's pretty powerful. And finally, I want to share with you what some of the popes have said. So obviously Pope John Paul II, but all down through the century even, Pope Pius X, Pope Pius XI, Pope Pius XII, were all promoters of this. And then Pope Benedict XV created a feast of Mary, mediatrix of all grace, in Belgium in 1921. So even a feast day honoring her under this title. So in his first encyclical on the Rosary, Pope Leo XIII, and I made a mistake, just people watching the videos, I said that Pope Leo XIII was one of the ones who did the chair of Peter, so I was wrong about that. But I just love Pope Leo XIII because he wrote so much about Mary. He wrote, he calls Mary the dispensatrix of heavenly graces. He was most forceful in his explanation of her role as the dispensatrix in one of his encyclicals, which called Octobri Mense, M-E-N-S-E, where he writes this. With equal truth can it be affirmed that, by the will of God, nothing of the immense treasury of every grace which the Lord has accumulated comes to us except through Mary. This is the Pope saying this. How great are the wisdom and mercy revealed in this design of God, confirmed by the testament of Christ when he said, "Behold your mother." It was understood from the beginning and accepted with utmost joy by the apostles and the earliest believers. It was also the belief and the teaching of the venerable fathers of the church. All Christian people of every age have accepted it unanimously. There is no other reason for this except for divine faith. So there you have it. I mean, it's always been the teaching of the church. So you might be hearing it for the first time. And hopefully with joy. I mean, I just think it's beautiful. A beautiful teaching that, you know, we haven't learned. But we're learning it now. So, all right, let's move on. We've read, we skipped 26, we read 27. All right, I promised I would explain this first sentence of 27, which is really pretty, I think you'll understand it because we've talked about it so much. 27, inasmuch as grace perfects nature, well, everybody gets that now, right? Because grace is the sharing of the divine life, and it obviously perfects our human nature. And glory perfects grace. Now, glory, whenever you see that word, it refers to being in heaven, okay? Glory perfects grace because, meaning receiving grace, because in glory we are all filled with grace at that point. We don't need more. So it perfects it. Okay, that's what that means. All right, so let's move ahead then to paragraph 28. Now this is a new section in the sense that he starts to focus on her role as a mother now. Okay, he's told us what her responsibilities are, Queen of Heaven, and oh, did I miss this? I did. Ooh, 28. I was going to say, I can't skip 28 because this is like one of my favorite paragraphs. This is like his grand finale, like of all her, you know, roles all rolled up into one paragraph. This is just so powerful right here. Okay. 28. In the heavens, Mary commands the angels and the blessed are the saints, as a recompense for her profound humility, again, there it is, God has empowered her and commissioned her to fill with saints the empty thrones from which the apostate angels fell by pride. The will of the Most High, who exalts the humble, is that heaven, earth, and hell bend, with good or bad will, to the commandments of the humble Mary, whom he has made sovereign of heaven and earth, general of his armies, treasurer of his treasures, dispenser of his graces, worker of his greatest marvels, restorer of the human race, mediatrix of men, the exterminator of the enemies of God, and the faithful companion of his grandeurs and triumphs. Wow. So it is. She's not just a meek little, you know. But you see how many times the word humble is used just in that one paragraph. You know, so it's important for us to pay attention to that. But, you know, she's been given the role to crush the head of Satan. So I guess using his words, in vain do we try to do it any other way. We need to include her in the pro-life movement. We need to include her in, you know, this election. We need to, whatever it is in your family life, with your spouse, with your children, you know, we need to be seeking her intercession with your own sins, you know, your own evil that you are battling. She's the one that's going to help you. She's going to crush. I'll tell her, I say, come in here and crush that, or this pride, or whatever it is, impatience, you know? So we need to be doing that. All right, so 28:9 then. Oh, let me just comment on that. How God has commissioned her to fill the empty thrones. Okay, well, we don't know if this is true or not, but someone told me that Mary appeared to St. Louis de Montfort, so maybe she told him this. But anyway, it's logical because God replaced Judas with Matthias, you know, and like even the 12 tribes of Israel that were scattered, you know, Jesus got the 12 apostles. Like, God does this. He reestablishes his order, you know. So it's not really illogical to think that he would fill the thrones of the angels who fell with Lucifer. But he's not going to create more angels, obviously. All the angels were created before the beginning of the world, and they have their place. So he told Mary, you just put Mary and saints in there, you know. So anyway, I don't know, it's not completely crazy to think that he would give her this role. Okay, let's go on. Paragraph 29 says, and this is a new section, as I said, focusing on her role as a mother. And notice the word, he uses the word God the Father, God the Son. They wish, they consent, they will, meaning that they're pleased to do this. It's their desire to make her whatever follows. God the Father wishes to have children by Mary until the consummation of the world, and he speaks to her these words, dwell in Jacob. That is to say, make your dwelling and residence in my predestined children, prefigured by Jacob, and not in the reprobate children of the devil, prefigured by Esau. Now, Jacob and Esau are two Old Testament people that we're going to look at a lot more later, but just for now, Jacob represents a predestinate soul. And if you remember from last time, the word predestinate, predestination, does not mean what it sounds like you won the spiritual lottery or something and you get to go to heaven, but you don't. And that's how God willed it. It doesn't matter what you do. That's crazy. Church has never taught that. Some of the John Calvin did. But what it means is, the word destined, just to review, means to direct. and to guide or to send. So God has given us, basically, predestined means he sees everything. He already knows ahead of time what we're going to decide, but he's given us the free will. He's given us the path. He's given us Jesus. And here's the plan, and here's the graces, and then it's up to us to decide if we're going to cooperate with those graces. So if you are a person cooperating with grace, you are what St. Louis de Montfort refers to as a predestined soul. And sometimes he says an elect. All right, so that's not, we're all loved and elect in God's eyes, right? But it's what we choose. Okay, so you can be a predestinate one day and a reprobate the next. And a reprobate is someone who has culpably, with full knowledge, set themselves against God or commit a mortal sin, what we call in Catholic Church. It has to be grave. They have to know it's grave, meaning serious matter, and they have to, with full consent of the will, decide to do it. All right? So we don't know in this age how many people are actually in the state of mortal sin because we don't know their hearts. We don't know what they've been taught. We don't know what their parents told them. We don't, you know? So, but that's what the word reprobate is, a person who has, by their own free will, chosen not to follow this path or this plan. All right, so that's when we see those words, and as we'll read later, the story of Jacob and Rebecca. Also, one other thing I want to point out is this, it looks like Ecclesiasticus, and I put in my note, or my question number three here, that actually is the book of Sirach. It took me forever to figure that out. And you'll often see in the book of Sirach, referring to wisdom. And wisdom is feminine in the Bible, if you've noticed. Wisdom has built her house, and wisdom this and wisdom that. Well, I was excited to see, because St. Louis de Montfort's always saying, using the word Mary in the place of wisdom, which I'm like, well, okay, I guess you can do that. And then I read that actually what Father Gaffney said, I'm going to read that to you real quick, just so going forward as you read and when you look, if you are to look it up in the Bible and you see that, well, it's not Mary, it's wisdom. Father Gaffney says, he says, the church, through listening primarily to the voice of eternal wisdom, hears also the voice of the Blessed Virgin Mary. For in them, according to the common understanding of medieval writers, the wisdom of God speaks in a certain sense in the person of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Oh, that's just so awesome. But, you know, it's feminine. So maybe this, God had that in mind through the scripture writers at the time of thinking of the Blessed Mother as he wrote about wisdom. So I wanted to share that with you, as I thought that was very helpful. All right, so we'll go on. Paragraph 30, he just talks about how you can't have the head without the body. And so because Mary helped form the head of the church, she also forms the body of the church. So he says, just as in the natural and the corporal generation of children, there are a father and a mother, so in the supernatural and spiritual generation, there are a father who is God and a Mary and a mother who is Mary. All true children of God, the predestinate, have God for their father and Mary for their mother. He who has not Mary for his mother has not God for his father. This is the reason why the reprobate, such as heretics, schismatics, and others who hate our Blessed Lady or regard her with contempt or indifference, have not God for their father, however much they boast of it, simply because they have not Mary for their mother. For if they had her for their mother, they would love her and honor her as a true child naturally loves and honors the mother who has given him life. The most infallible and indubitable sign by which we may distinguish a heretic, a man of bad doctrine, a reprobate, from one of the predestinate is that a heretic and the reprobate have nothing but contempt and indifference for Our Lady, endeavoring by their words and examples to diminish the worship and love of her, openly or hiddenly, and sometimes by misrepresentation. Alas, God the Father has not told Mary to dwell in them, for they are Esau's. All right, so, question number three. And I think this is important that we understand this, because as I said at the beginning of the year, he's writing to Catholics. Well-catechized Catholics. What? Yes, let's look at question number three. So because if you think he's saying something against your Protestant friends, let's clear that up right now because I want everyone to understand. It says in paragraph 29, St. Louis de Montfort starts another Trinitarian series, this time focusing on Mary as mother. Okay, in 30 he makes what seems to be a startling claim when he says that he who has not Mary for his mother has not God for his father. So what, if anything, is he saying here about non-Catholic Christians? Nothing. First of all, if they're baptized, validly baptized, Mary's their mother. They might not know it. First of all, she's their mother. All right, so he is not talking about Protestant people today. Now, Protestant people in the early Protestantism, who were Catholics, by the way, to begin with, because all Christians were Catholics at the time, they were culpable. You see the difference. But most Protestants today have been raised with, you know, prejudices against church or Mary or, you know, preconceived ideas, misconceptions. You know, it's not their fault. You know, what if someone came to you and said, everything you've been taught is wrong? I mean, you know, that they're just doing their best, most of them, you know, and trying to just, they're seeking the truth, most of them. So what he's talking about here is, and he says it right here, but that's why we need to define these terms. He's talking about Catholics who are well catechized. Again, not many today. Unfortunately, a lot of Catholics today don't even fall into this category. He's talking about well catechized Catholics who are culpable, who have cut themselves off by their own free choice. And that's why, if you look at the last sentence, it says, alas, God the Father has not told Mary to dwell in them, for they are Esau's, but they're first Esau's by choice. So this is, again, very logical. When you commit a mortal sin, what happens to the indwelling of the Holy Trinity? You lose it. Right, it's gone. So Mary's gone too. You know, it's logical. So God the Father has told Mary not to dwell there because it's a natural consequence of kicking God out, which they don't, they're not thinking that they're doing that, right? But that's what happens. They lose sanctifying grace, and they lose the mother of grace, and that's all he means. So if you look, and we don't use the word heretic because it sounds really mean, but there are heretics today, unfortunately. And again, you can't even judge them because we don't know what they were taught, and even in their seminaries they may have been taught wrong or incorrectly. But you know, we need to, you know, we still need to evangelize. We still need to speak the truth, even when it's difficult. You know, even our Protestant brothers and sisters, tell them that Mary is their mother and that she loves them. And that, as the Memorari says, anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession was left unaided. Anyone. And maybe you can't get them to say one Hail Mary a day, but maybe you can say, you know, just try it. Just say, Mary, if you really are my mother, show me. And then let her take over. You know, we don't have to try to convince them and change them. God does that. But we are supposed to speak the truth and tell them the truth. Now, the definition of a heretic is a Catholic who causes division in the church. Okay? They know what they're doing. They know what they're doing. They're well catechized. They're culpable. All right? So as again, so I don't know how many of heretics there actually are today. I don't know. We don't know how many people are truly heretics, who are truly living in the state of sin. And then a schismatic, am I saying that right? Is a person who, I said that backwards. A heretic is someone who spreads false doctrine. Okay? A schismatic is a person who causes division in the church because of their disobedience to the Pope. All right, so we need to make sure we understand what he's talking about, and that's why a lot of people don't read this book. They're like, wait a minute, you know, what's he saying here? God's not the father of the Protestants, you know? Okay, so we really need to, I hope that that clears up all that those misconceptions that you may have had when you read it the first time. And remember, as I said, the very first meeting, you have to go back to 1700. You know, you have to go back and realize who his audience was. You cannot read this in 2012 and expect it to mean the exact same thing. But that's what's so wonderful about reading it, because there are so many beautiful truths and jewels hidden in this book, and we just need to look at them again through the eyes of Vatican II, really, is what we're doing. Okay. Let's go on. How much time do I have? Okay, 15 minutes. We'll go fast. I got one question, so maybe we can finish. Where was I? All right. 31. God the Son wishes to form himself and, so to speak, to incarnate himself in his members every day by his dear mother. And he says to her, take Israel for your inheritance. It is as if he had said, God the Father has given me for my inheritance all the nations of the earth, all men, good and bad, the predestinate and the reprobate. The ones I will leave with a rod of gold, and the others with a rod of iron. Of the ones I will be the father and the advocate, of the others the just punisher, and of all the judge. But as for you, my dear mother, you shall have for your heritage and possession only the predestinate, prefigured by Israel. And as their mother, you shall bring them forth and take care of them. And as their sovereign, you shall conduct them, govern them, and defend them. I really like this paragraph a lot because, first of all, what he's saying here is that God is the Father. Jesus, this whole rod of iron, rod of gold, is that God is just, perfectly just, and perfectly merciful. And so depending on how you live your life, you'll either be given the gold, which is your reward, he's just, or your eternal punishment, which you brought on yourself by your free will, right? God doesn't send people to hell, you send yourself. You know, he doesn't want you to go there. He gives you as many chances as he can, obviously. But Mary, I love this, she is only mercy. She does not judge, she does not punish. She is a mother, that's why we call her the mother of mercy. And I love that. So you don't ever have to fear her. She doesn't get mad at you. She, you know, she's not like sighing like I do at my kids 24/7, it seems like, you know. No, she's not doing that. She's merciful. And mercy is miraculous because it's more than forgiveness. Forgiveness is divine. And forgiveness is if someone comes and says they're sorry and you forgive them. But mercy is beyond that. Mercy is forgiving you before you've even said sorry. You know, we killed her son. Have you wept for that yet? Mary loved you before you were sorry, before you repented. The mother of mercy, it's a gift that we can't even fathom. And the more that you meditate on the passion, and that is the key. I mean, all the saints say it. Meditating on the passion is the key to unlocking the mysteries of God's love, of Mary's love. And to meditate on the seven sorrows, I'm trying to do that more this year. It really does. It gives you a more of a deeper insight of how much she loves you. And sometimes I bust out crying because I just get overwhelmed at the thought of how much she loves me and how much I don't deserve it. And I become more conscious of my own sins and what I did to Jesus. And that's what this is all about, because you cry and then you receive healing, you know, and then, like we just read in the beginning, you're forgiven, your sins are forgiven. And what do these people do in the Bible? They jump up, they're filled with joy, you know. And so Mary wants to you to bring each area of weakness of your life to her son. But she has to show you what it is first. Sometimes you don't know. So, you know, maybe you're suffering from anxiety or fear or depression and all these things. You know, Jesus didn't come just to save us when we die. He came to save us now. You know, that's why we go to the Eucharist. That's why we go to confession. That's why, you know, we have healing teams at St. Gertrude. We're so blessed. And I encourage you all to take advantage of this. Go, be prayed over, receive healing, go to confession, receive the sacraments. They're there to heal you. And then you can, like my college roommate said, you're not the same Anne. Yeah, because that Anne has been healed. Praise be to God. I can sit here and speak, because then you can go and evangelize. You know, once you're healed and you're forgiven, and that's when they go out, you know, and evangelize in the scripture. People, like, pick up their mat, and Jesus is like, don't tell anybody. Well, he can't contain it. He goes and tells everyone. You know, that's what the effect of being healed and forgiven does. And so I'm just so excited, I know, in this year of faith that we're going to just see this more and more and more, because it's also the new evangelization. You can't have the new evangelization unless you have the healing and the forgiving first. Okay, so that's what we're all about, and that's what Mary is all about. And it's not, you know, it's not always easy to go back and look at your past or look at what's causing these problems, but it's so worth it to get them out, you know? All right, so let's go on. Okay, so I'm going to skip 32 only because he just, I'll summarize it. He's like, you can't have a head without a body, and you can't have a body without a head. So he basically just says that Mary is the mother of Christ and the body of Christ. So he describes how, you know, it's a family. You know, we have a mother and a father. You know, it's not just me and Jesus. You know, that's wonderful, but you are missing out. You're missing out on this beautiful, wonderful family. You know, where you have brothers and sisters, you have saints, you have angels, you know, and I really have just, the angels have just been such a gift lately, praying to the angels. And I know that God is increasing my faith. Number one, I ask for it daily. I ask for it at Mass during the consecration daily. And not only am I starting to feel the presence of the angels, but I'm starting to feel the presence of the poor souls when I drive by graveyards. I feel them. And I ask them favors. And I'll just tell you a really quick story. But Saturday, my son went to homecoming. First time ever, first date. And we were praying in front of the abortion clinic because I wanted to help hammer the crosses in, and we didn't. And I'm like, well, let's at least do that. So he had an hour before I had to take him to get to homecoming, the dinner. And we're sitting there in front of the abortion clinic, and I'm like, oh my gosh, you need a corsage. An hour before. And so I'm like, oh my gosh, what color is her dress? And so we leave after one decade, okay? We were there for like, what, 5 minutes in front of the abortion clinic. But anyway. So we're driving to the Harper's Point Kroger, and there's the Gate of Heaven there. And I'm like, holy souls, I need a favor. You know, and this is what, the holy souls, where we pay you 1,000 times over. And we drive by there, every cemetery we pass, we pray for the holy souls. Always have. And I always say when we go on vacation, they're so excited when we come back. I tell my kids that. I'm like, the holy souls are so happy we're back, because we pass them multiple times a day. But anyway, so we're right there, and I get all my kids, and it was just a great way to evangelize, help them to see, and I thank God for this miracle. But anyway, holy souls, we need your help. We have an hour. So we get to, I drop my son off at Kroger, and I go to the flower store across the street, and it says on the a sign, order, order your homecoming flowers here. And I'm like, we're doomed, you know? But I still had this hope, I did, for the poor souls. So I go in, and it was super expensive there, but they said they could do it in an hour. And I'm like, well, let's just look in the Kroger. One white corsage with a little bit of green, and her dress was green. $20. So, of course, we were, oh, thank you, holy souls, and we, you know, stopped. But what a beautiful, you know, I was so happy that the miracle occurred. I knew it would, though. I just did. But that's because this is what God will do. He will give you more faith. And the more faith you have, you start to feel the spiritual. You just do. Like I feel the angels. I call them down upon here. And I just, I think about it. I don't like have a supernatural, like out of body experience or anything. But I just know. See, faith is knowing. You know, it's knowing things that can't be seen. Or whatever, I don't know the exact verse. All right, and I went way off, so, but I just had to tell that story because I don't even know why. Well, it's to help your faith, I guess, right? All right, so, oh, I know, I was skipping that paragraph saying that she can't, I don't know. Anyway, I don't know what got me off there. But let's look and let's finish this. Okay. This is a question that people have, and I want to make sure that we clear this up as well. Number 33. So besides this meaning that Mary is the mother of the body and the head, Jesus being present as much as ever, the fruit of Mary, as heaven and earth repeat thousands and thousands of times a day, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus, it is certain that Jesus Christ is, for each man in particular who possesses him, as truly the fruit and the work of Mary as he is for the whole world in general. So that if any one of the faithful has Jesus Christ formed in his heart, he can say boldly, all thanks be to Mary. What I possess in her, what I possess is her effect and her fruit. And without her, I should never have had it. We can apply to her more the words, more than St. Paul applied to himself these words. I am in labor again with all the children of God until Jesus Christ, my son, be formed in them in the fullness of his age. So we talked about that. Mary gave labor at the foot of the cross, which is what Revelation, and she wailed aloud in pain, which of course we know she didn't wail aloud. Well, we don't know. We weren't there, but I'm assuming she had dignity and she was helping her son and comforting him in great pain. But that is what this whole idea of her giving labor to the children of the head, us. He ends this with such a beautiful quote of St. Augustine. He says, St. Augustine, surpassing himself and going beyond all I have yet said, affirms that all the predestinate, in order to be conformed to the image of the Son of God, are in this world hidden in the womb of the Most Holy Virgin, where they are guarded, nourished, brought up, and made to grow by that good mother until she has brought them forth to glory after death, which is properly the day of their birth, as the Church calls the death of the just. O mystery of grace unknown, to the reprobate, and but little known even to the predestinate. So that just that verse paragraph right up above, it says, so all the graces you have received, whether you're Catholic or whether you're Protestant or whether you're Jewish or whether you're Muslim, you received from Mary. You don't know it, but that's what he's saying there. All thanks be to Mary that I know Jesus, that I know him for who he really is. You know, and she'll help you to bring you more fully into that knowledge. She'll help Scripture to make more sense, for the teachings of the Church to make more sense. But I love this whole idea of living this life in the womb of Mary, you know, protected. And as I said, I missed it, but where he says she's our mother, but she's our queen. And so she's protecting us from so much evil that we don't even know. And so total consecration, like, puts you in, I say, to the heart of Mary or to the womb of Mary in this life. And in the Catholic Church, we often have the feast day of the saint as their death day, because it's their birth into eternal life. So Mary will be there to birth us into eternal life. And I often hear many people, and even just yesterday, a lady said to me, her grandfather died, who was very devoted to Mary, and right before he died, he put his arms out, and she's like, and I know he saw the Blessed Mother. And so, you know, if you're devoted to her, and you're totally consecrated to her, and St. Louis de Montfort says this later in the book, but I firmly believe that Mary will be there, because you pray your whole life, pray for me now, and at the hour of my death, you know, she's going to. So, all right, let's end then with this last section, which is on the Holy Spirit. And I'm sorry that some of you have to go. We're almost at 11:30, but this is so beautiful and one of really my favorite parts, because I just love anything about the Holy Spirit. It says, God the Holy Spirit wishes to form the elect for himself and her and by her. And he says to her, strike the roots, my well-beloved and my spouse, of all your virtues in my elect, in order that they may grow from virtue to virtue and from grace to grace. I took so much complacence in you when you lived on earth and the practice of the most sublime virtues that I desire still to find you on earth without your ceasing to be in heaven. For this end, reproduce yourself in my elect, that I may behold in them with complacence the roots of your invincible faith, of your profound humility, of your universal mortification, of your sublime prayer, of your ardent charity, of your firm hope, and of all your virtues. You are always my spouse, as faithful, as pure, and as fruitful as ever. Let your faith give me my faithful, your purity my virgins, and your fertility my temples and my elect. So it's so beautiful how it reads, like I write here in the question, and it's kind of like a love letter almost, how much he loved Mary, the Holy Spirit loves Mary so much, and that he wishes to find her in us. And that, and we'll talk about later in the year, but through total consecration, she shares her virtues with you. So all these things, he listed some of her virtues, her humility, her mortification, which is always still a hard one for me. But anyway, her prayer, her charity, her hope, all these virtues, she imparts these to you through total consecration, and really in a miraculous way. And it's such a gift. I'll go on here. When Mary has struck her roots in a soul, she produces there marvels of grace, which she alone can produce, because she alone is the fruitful virgin who never has had and never will have her equal in purity and fruitfulness. Mary has produced, together with the Holy Ghost, the greatest thing which has ever been or ever will be, a God-man. And she will consequently produce the greatest saints that there will be, and in the end of time. The formation and the education of the great saints who shall come at the end of the world are reserved for her. For it is only that singular and miraculous virgin who can produce, in union with the Holy Ghost, singular and extraordinary things. Now, do you realize what we just read? And it's so exciting. The next couple of meetings are all about this end time, which, you know, we don't know when the world's going to end, but it does seem like it's possibly the end of something. And I don't know, and nobody knows. I don't think it's going to be the end of the world or anything. But we are in this age of Mary, as we've talked about, and we know this is true. We had the Marian popes, and Benedict is a Marian pope as well. We've had Marian apparitions like crazy. Obviously, many are still being investigated, but, you know, you're just seeing true devotion to Mary. He's going to be declared doctor of the church, I believe, soon, and then it's really going to explode. But anyway, these great saints, that's what you're here for. You know, that's why you're here. And don't think for a moment that she can't do it, because it's not about you and what you can do. It's about what her and what she can do. Okay, because it's very easy to sit back and start having almost a false humility. You know, I'm not worthy, and, you know, I've done all these things, or, you know, I just can't, and all this, and you've got to forget about that, okay? Because you're right. We aren't. We can't. But she can, and that's what you have to convince yourself of. She can. She raised Jesus in his humanity to be the perfect man. You know, he was God, yes, but he was human as well. And she raised him. She taught him. You can imagine, to the best of all mothers. She's good at it. And you're here because she wants to make you into a great Marian saint. Don't doubt it. Seriously. Okay, so it's something, just open yourself to her. Just give yourself to her and let her go to work. You know, all you got to do is just say your little fiat every now and then, you know, and then you're going to fall on your face every now and then. Of course, I do daily. But that's okay. You know, we're going to mess up and we're going to fall and we're going to be scared and all this. But, you know, just invite her in. And that's what total consecration is all about. Invite her in and let her go to work, and she can do it. She can turn you into a great saint, and she's been commissioned to do it during these times. Because where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. And it's no secret that we're living in very sinful times. So it makes sense. And this year of faith, I mean, it's exciting. It really is. Be excited. Don't be afraid. You know how you cannot be afraid? What the trick I've learned is to not worry about everything. It's just to live in the now. You know, live in the present moment. And stop worrying about the future. You know, God tells us not to worry in Scripture. And someone said to me yesterday, it's kind of cute. They said, you know, someone told me that 90% of the things you worry about never happen. So worrying works. So that's kind of cute, but actually, you know, we want to trust more. And so as I just keep telling myself, I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. And he's all powerful, and he loves me, and he's in control, and he brings good out of everything. So we just have to try to focus on right now, because when you focus on right now, then you don't miss opportunities to receive and give grace, you know, to others. That's just been the thing that's helped me the most. When I realize, when I start worrying, I just keep coming back to what's in front of me right now. Oh, look, it's a cute little 10-year-old. You know, I'm going to enjoy her instead of worrying about what's on the news or whatever. Okay, finally, this last paragraph is one of my favorites, and we'll end with this. I was going to read to you a little bit of this 33 Days to Morning Glory, but we're not going to have time. But he, and I sent you an email about this 33 Days to Morning Glory, which is just a 33-day consecration, what we're going to do in the spring. But Father Michael Gately broke this down into four sections. And so the first section, he looks at St. Louis de Montfort very briefly, and then St. Maximian Kolbe, and then Mother Teresa, and then John Paul II. So it's just really great. I was going to read you some of St. Maximian Kolbe, what he says about Mary being the spouse of the Holy Spirit. But let's just look here. I won't have time, so maybe you can get that book. I'll bring it up again later in the year. It's nice to read even while we do our 33 days in the spring. Okay, 36, one of my favorite paragraphs. When the Holy Ghost, her spouse, Mary's spouse, has found Mary in a soul, he flies there. He enters there in his fullness. He communicates himself to that soul abundantly and to the full extent to which it makes room for his spouse. Nay, one of the greatest reasons why the Holy Ghost does not now do startling wonders in our souls is because he does not find there a sufficiently great union with his faithful and inseparable spouse. I say inseparable spouse because since the substantial love of the Father and the Son, and that's the Holy Spirit, has espoused Mary in order to produce Jesus Christ, the head of the elect, and Jesus Christ in the elect, he has never repudiated her because she has always been fruitful and faithful. So I remind the Holy Spirit of this all the time. I'm like, you see Mary's here? You come, you give me those gifts, and I want them now, and I want them fully, and okay. But I do. I'm always reminding him of this paragraph. Anyway, so, but it's to the full extent that you make room for Mary. Okay, so we start with Mary. We start with her. So let's look at the fourth question. The last question we'll end today. How do we increase our devotion to Mary? We haven't consecrated yet, some of us. So what can we do now? What can we do today? Well, I mean, it's really not difficult. Just start talking to her. You know, if you've never talked to her outside of a Hail Mary, you need to develop a personal, intimate relationship with her, like a friend, like a mother. You know, and so just start saying, you know, Mary, are you there? Do you care? Are you really interested in every detail of my life, and just start asking her these questions, and she will show herself to you in different ways and in different forms, okay? Obey the Fatima message. You know, that is one way to get straight to her heart. Pray the daily rosary as best you can. You know, if you can only do a decade, do a decade. At least you're showing her that you're trying. You know, if you can pray with your family, great. I don't get it every night with my family. I try, but you know how hard it is with teenagers and kids, and they're gone and they're sports, and we probably get 4 out of 7 nights in. Do I feel bad? No, I don't feel bad when I miss a night, because I know my duties come first, and that's what Mother wants, and I'm doing the best I can. So let's just try harder, just make it a higher priority to get that rosary in. Mary also asked us at Fatima to do the first 5 Saturdays of reparation. All right, we can't wait for everybody else to do this. We need to do this. So start in November and do 5 first Saturdays, and Google it if you want more information, and then repeat it. And so I'll do 5, and then I'll take a year off because of whatever. I don't mean to, but, and then I'll do 5 again. So it's just an ongoing thing. Okay, wear her sacramentals, her scapular, her miraculous medals. Get them blessed and wear them. They are powerful. The devil hates them. He honestly won't bother you as much when you're wearing them. It's the truth. And this is something Father Al Lauer said, which is ask Jesus. Ask the Lord to help you to love his mother more, because he's going to answer that prayer, because he knows that she's going to bring you closer to him, which is the ultimate goal of going to Mary. Okay, and then finally I have total consecration, of course, which we're doing this year. And then read books on her, study her. You know, take the time, even if it's just a paragraph a night before you go to bed. There's so many wonderful, wonderful books. So it's exciting. Be excited. Don't be nervous or afraid. Yes.
October 13th.
Yes. Thank you for reminding me. 95th. I said it wrong on the video. Yes. Yes. So this Saturday, pray a rosary. It's the 95th at noon. Well, if you can, at noon, they're having... So this Saturday is a 95th anniversary. I said 75th on the video in the first meeting. So, yes, that would be a good place to start this Saturday. And Father Apostoli, who is a wonderful priest, always on EWTN, and he wrote the book called Fatima for Today. So it's going to be really a good talk. I'm looking forward to that. All right, so let's end with prayer, and we'll just bring all of our... If everybody just wants to bring all your intentions to Jesus through Mary, right now, just quietly. God knows our hearts, but we first just want to give thanksgiving. Mary helps us to give a greater thanksgiving and greater praise, and I thank her for that. We thank you just for allowing us to be here and for all the blessings that you bestow on us. Help us to focus on our blessings. Help us to be people of thanksgiving, because that chases away sadness and despair. But we bring to you all our personal intentions today, Lord. And we pray especially for this great nation, for our country, and we just ask for an end to all the, especially those who don't respect life from conception till natural death. We ask for you to enlighten hearts. We pray to all the guardian angels of everyone in this country to help enlighten people's hearts to the truth of this dignity of the human person. We ask all this in Jesus' name as we pray. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, it never was it known. Anyone who fled to thy protection, implored thy help, or sought thy intercession, was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly unto thee, O Virgin of virgins, our mother. To thee we come, before thee I stand, sinful and sorrowful. Mother of the Word incarnate, despise not my petitions. In thy mercy, hear and answer me. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit.